Okay, we are back on the record on our agenda. Next on the agenda is the audit presentation. Michelle?
Thank you. On an annual basis, we are required to have an audit done by a certified accounting firm. And tonight we have Jennifer Watkins from Yo and Yo to present the results of the 2015-16 audit. So I will turn it over to Jennifer.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for having me. Also with me tonight is Mike Everard, who's the lead in charge manager at your job. So he was out here every day making sure everything got done and probably knows the ins and outs better than all of us. I think he's looked at things 20 times probably just today. So he's very good and he does a great job for us. In front of you, I'll just mention, you guys have the presentation that we'll be going over tonight, what you'll be seeing on the screen. You also have the actual audit report found, and then in the back of that audit report, the bigger copy, is what we call the management letter. That's the letter to governance. So that's our required communications to you, where if you had any recommendations, they would be included in there. We'd also go over them with you at this time as well. Also, you have a smaller report. It's found, that's your single audit report. That has all of your federal dollars. We audited the nutrition cluster. We'll go over that as well during the presentation, but just so you kind of know what you're getting into. The single audit report is where you would find if you had any more serious issues, so like significant deficiencies or material weaknesses or material non-compliance. That would be included in the single audit report, because that's how the state requires it. You didn't have any, so they're not included in there, but that's where you would find them. Okay, so a little bit about myself. I'll brag about myself for a second. I am a principal with Yo and Yo. I've been with them 11 years. I am the head of the education service line for our whole organization. We audit about 87, maybe almost 90 schools now. So I'm kind of the lead in getting the training up to everybody and figuring out what's going on, which makes it good because I look at a lot of schools. I really enjoy school districts. I enjoy, kind of have a passion for it, and it makes me really enjoy my job. I also sit on the 1022 committee at the state. They are the ones that write the accounting manual for what Rochelle does every day. So that's nice because I know what the changes are when they're coming up. I also sit on the 8133 reference group. It's a little bit of an old name. It's now the CFR 200 or the UG standards that everybody's been hearing so much about. But they write the audit manual. So everything that I have to do when I come on the audit, basically from the state, from a compliance standpoint, that's what they write. So it helps to keep me up to date, know everything that's new and changing. I also present a lot at MCO, but this year will be my first time presenting at the MASB conference. So if any of you are going to be there, I will be there since the first weekend in November. So me and another principal from our SAGNA office will be presenting. Okay, so this is a slide just to tell you what the district's responsibilities are during the audit. They are the district's financial statements. They are not you and your financial statements. We just give you an opinion on them. So you are responsible for them. We would let you know if we made any large adjustments or something that made them, you know, not yours. You are responsible to review them and look at them, and we sat down with Michelle and Paula and went through that also. Our responsibility, the auditor's responsibility, is basically to conduct the audit and give you enough assurance, or give us enough assurance by the end of the day, that we can say your audit is free from any material adjustments. So an outside user looking at these statements can say that they wouldn't change their mind, or if we felt anything different, that it would change their mind or what they thought about the financial statements. So we do lots of procedures and lots of risk assessments to get it down to a level where we can say they're free from any material changes. And this is just a little bit of the audit procedures we do. I won't read them all to you, but it starts basically with the auditor's understanding of internal control. So this year being our first year here at the district, that took a little bit longer than probably normally. Usually it's a refreshing of understanding the internal controls, but we really got deep into it with the business office this year. From then, we take that and we form a risk assessment where we have to see what the riskiest areas are. So normally we look at the 60-day rule for schools, or we look at the compliance that the state puts on you and all the new requirements that they have for you, and decide where are those risky areas and where are we going to focus our time. From then we do different procedures to make sure that we have, to make sure there's no material weaknesses in there, significant deficiencies, but then also we do other things, consider like unpredictability. This year we were a little bit even more unpredictable because we were new, and we also did some extra procedures at the end of it. But every year we come out, we always do unpredictability. So we don't, kind of, if you have an audit, every year an audit, there's always the same things we ask for. So when we come out, we always like to throw something in there that they're not expecting that would be a surprise, just so that they don't get too complacent in what we're asking for. Also, the GASB 68, you guys probably heard a ton about GASB 68 last year. That was in place and going all year this year for the second year. Your GASB 68, I think the net pension liability went up to about $183 million this year. So just something to consider. We are doing testing of that while we're out here. We're making sure that your payments are getting into the ORS system correctly so that that number is accurate on your books. So our internal control evaluation is important. You know, we don't place an opinion on your internal controls, but we do have to let you know if we find anything during the process that needs to be brought to your attention. We did not find any material weaknesses or significant deficiencies on your internal control. With the single audit, that's, again, as I said before, our audit over the federal expenditures that you spend, you are considered a low-risk auditee. Basically, what that means is that we have to audit 20% of your total expenditures. If you were a high-risk auditee, you'd have to do 40%. So this year, we did the nutrition cluster. No areas were noted there that were material weakness or material non-compliance, and we do issue two opinions on that report, and both of which were unmodified. So in that letter that I was talking about earlier, the governance letter, there is an area for significant estimates. We have to let you know what numbers are in your audit that are considered to be significant estimates. This year there's two. One is the useful lives of the property and equipment, and the other one is the net pension liability, because that comes from the actuarial valuations from ORS and from their CAFR, and then it goes through that process. And we basically get a lot of numbers from them, and they tell us what those numbers are, and it's all based on different assumptions. So, and that's a huge number to your guys' statement, so of course that's significant. Also in there is a lot of regulatory items. A lot of new updates that are happening this year. This year was the first year that uniform grant guidance was in full effect for you. So basically it changed a couple of things. I'm sure your auditors told you about last year, but it changed the major program determination up to $750,000. So now if you have programs under that $750,000, they're not considered a major program. Well, they could be, but they're not considered an A major program. We go through quite a bit of figuring out what programs to test and which ones we have to. And that made it actually a little bit more simpler, focusing on the bigger programs that are more significant to your district. The early warning legislation, we will talk about this too later in the presentation, but the biggest new thing with this is the 5%. The state changed it. People were advocating for this forever, and they finally changed it, but they are looking at 5% of your fund balance over unrestricted revenue. So it's taking out that federal expenditures and the federal revenue and anything restricted that you guys can't control. So when you get federal money in, you have Budgeting and Accounting Act this year. MD has stated, Lori Sluggett was at the conference and said that they have a zero tolerance. So any expenditures at all that were over budget could be a rise for a letter from MDE. They're taking it very seriously. It's gone anywhere from 5% over before why I've been auditing schools to 1%, now 0%. So if you spend over your budget in total for total expenditures or total other, you would get a letter from MDE and then have to explain. We'll also go over your budget to actual results. The other required communications in that letter, if we had disagreements with management, which we did not, we'd let you know. Any difficulties in performing the audit, such as things taking too long to receive or things coming to us that weren't complete, we would also let you know. Any uncorrected misstatements, which we had none, or if we had significant audit adjustments. So if what you were seeing on a month-to-month basis was changing, so what you got from what we got from the auditors is their chart from the business office, is their trial balance, is what you were seeing in the audit. We did not have some of the audit adjustments, which is a very good thing for a business office. And again, you guys had a clean opinion on your overall audit, which in total, what really it says is that it's raw material misstatement. Okay, to the numbers. So this page references your governmental funds balance sheet. So if you look back at the actual audit report, or if you want to later to compare, this is page 4-4. So your general fund ended at about $24.3 million. Your 2008 capital projects fund and your 2010 Series A capital projects fund, both were also considered to be major funds this year. So your 2008 ended at $4.1 million, and the 2010 ended at $5.7. All your other non-major governmental funds were about $6.3 million ending the year, with total assets of $40.5 million for the district. This is the liabilities for the governmental funds. This is also on page 4-4. General fund is $18 million in liabilities. Your largest items there are related to payroll, and then you're due to other funds. So that's very normal. You can see your salaries payable, and then your other accrued payroll liabilities, which is retirement and benefits. The total for governmental funds for the fiscal year was about $19 million. Biggest there would be the $18 million from the general fund. All the other funds were fairly small. Your next page is the fund balance for your governmental funds. So this page references 4-5 in your audit report. And it just goes through the fund balances. I think probably when BSP 65 and 63 came out, we talked a lot about what's non-expendable, what's restricted, all the new terminology. But you guys have a pretty well breakdown of what your fund balance is made up of. Your total unassigned, though, the balance that is not assigned for anything at your end in general fund is about $5.5 million. So the general fund total fund balance is $6.3, which has a little bit assigned for the severance liability and then also some non-spendable for your prepaids. The other two major funds, the capital projects, those are both restricted for capital project use. You cannot use them for anything besides in those capital project funds. And then your non-major funds, you'll see over there at the very end, ended with 5.9 in fund balance, so leaving your district with a total of 21.45 fund balance for the year. Okay, this sheet is looking at your statement of net position, specifically at capital assets. So this is your district-wide information. This is not your governmental funds. You'll see at the end of the year, and this references page 4-1 in your audit report, but your net capital assets are we're down slightly from the year before at $262 million. And this again is your district-wide information, your statement of net position, the long-term debt section. So this breaks down what's in there on page 4-2, what is all included in your long-term debt. And then also we separate out your net pension liability. So you had total bonds of $205 million. That was reduced by payments of 12.1. And then you had premiums, your interest rate swap ended the year at 17.3. No, 14.6, sorry, I have my glasses and I'm pretty close. Your school loan revolving fund with the interest, the two items there kind of together, they go coinciding, it's about $83 million. And then you had the severance liability of $257,000, compensated absences of $2.8 million. So your normal regular long-term debt is $324 million. Then you add in your GASB 68 item, the net pension liability at $183 million, almost $184. And you end the year at $508 million for long-term debt on your district-wide statements. So I'm sure you guys talked about it a lot, but that net pension liability is not affecting your governmental funds. It's not affecting your general fund. It's only affecting district-wide. This slide shows your general fund comparisons to budget. So you have revenues and other sources, and your expenditures and other uses. You have final, well, original budget, final budget, and actual. So over, on the end, you see your difference. You are under budget in revenue by less than 1%, and you are over budget in expenditure, or under budget, I'm sorry, in expenditures by just over 1%. So as far as I go with as many schools as I look at, that is a terrific budget variance, especially on the large expenditure and budget that you guys have to work with. It's a very good difference.
Jennifer, I'm sorry, yeah. Good question about that. Does this also include the 5% that needs to be held back from the state?
This includes everything.
Okay.
So when we're looking at these numbers, the revenues include all your revenue that you received for general fund for the year. So it doesn't have anything to do with what your fund balance was at the end of the year. Okay. It includes the unrestricted, I think you're talking about the unrestricted, yes. It includes unrestricted, local, so section 5 is your like budget to actual report in the audit where you can see by function, instruction, supporting. It breaks it down a lot more than this does, budget to actual, but you can, you'll be able to tie back those revenue amounts.
Thank you.
Okay, this pie chart represents your revenue for, and this would be a good follow-up, I guess. It includes all of this. In those numbers, but this includes your revenue just for the general fund though. So you can see the majority of your revenue comes from state, following up with property taxes, which, well, local revenue make mostly property taxes. So that makes up basically your foundation allowance. And then thirdly would be your federal revenue. So that is all restricted. And then just a little bit extra made up in others. This pie chart represents your general fund expenditures by function. So you can see, obviously, the majority is construction at $69 million at 63%. That is very typical for district. Second, obviously, is supporting services at 34%. And then you have very minimal in the other categories. this one is the same expenditures numbers in total, but you see it by objects level, so it's broke down by all of the school districts accounting you can do by objects level. So they have salaries, benefits, supplies, purchase services, and basically other capital outlay. So you can see that with employee benefits and salaries, you're sitting at 81%, which is pretty much what I see for schools, but really for you guys, it's a little bit higher. I've been seeing some districts with purchase services going to almost 20% because they're having to outsource so much. So it says you guys are paying a lot of costs back into your people.
I'm sorry, could you thank you. You just said salary benefits were, what did you say?
91.
Yeah, okay, because that's what I figured.
Sorry.
Good, thanks.
Which is even higher. I just did one last week, and it's a deficit district, so they're, you know, I mean, they're having to push more and more costs to purchase services, and they're having to, you know, lay off or reduce their staff by a lot, and you start to see this graph that we do in so many shift. This slide is your 10-year enrollment analysis. You start at 2007, and it goes to 2016. So you can see there was quite a bit in 2010. That was your highest at just over 12,000. And then last year, you were at 10,849 students. So usually, there is a direct correspondence with this graph and your overall revenue if you took that to your writer. Just because what you guys can control, or maybe control, but what sets your guys' budget and your revenue budget for the whole year is basically based on how many students you get in your school. Schools don't have a lot of drivers of revenue or a lot of ways to make up extra revenue besides student count. This is a 10-year foundation allowance trend starting also in 2007 and going to 2016. And then your general fund balance. So this goes from 2008 to 2016. You can see we have showing the total fund balance. And then also, once it started with the new GASB's out, the unassigned portion of that fund balance. So in 2008, you had almost 28 million in fund balance, and you're at 5.5 million in 2016 of unassigned, with the total of 6.3, and this is just general fund balance. So this is what we talked about earlier with that unrestricted revenue. So for 2016, your fund balance as a percentage of your unrestricted revenue is 7.4%, so you are higher than that 5% mark. Also for 2015, as a comparison, it's at 9.3%. We also put up here your fund balance as a percent of your operating expenditures, just because that's kind of what people are used to looking at. But the new rate that the state is focusing on is that unrestricted revenue number.
Well, and that says that earlier you mentioned on the early morning the comparison that the state acts upon 5%. So the figure you're using for comparison is 7.4%.
Yes, yep. And they have several factors. It's how fast your enrollment's declining, if you've lost, you know, revenue over year, but that is the newest and most, I guess, hot topic one that they've been talking about. The next slide is your mixers rate history. So just kind of to see what's making those benefit costs go up so much. And I'm sure you guys talk a lot about this, but from 2007, it was at 17.74%. For 2017, it is estimated that it's going to be up to 36.64%. That is including the UAAL, the 147C amount. So it was capped out, I think in 2012 with the payroll reform and the retirement reform, at about 25%. So that amount from the blue line to the green line is being made up, I guess you could say, with 147C money. But that is money that you receive in, and then you pay out with MDE, and GASB requires you to record it as an expenditure. So the 36% is a true expenditure percentage that you're seeing on your books. That's how much percentage of retirement that you see.
Just for clarification and for our community, this is a retirement. This is what we're paying retirement. That's what this is.
Yes. Sorry. Stop me anytime I do that because sometimes I talk in code. Or a letter. Some of the new things that are coming out are the GASB statement, 74 and 75. So kind of how we talk so much about 68 when it was coming out, this is basically the same thing, only we're going to be doing the same thing we did with the defined benefit piece, we're going to do with the OPEB piece. So right now, all that net pension liability in GASB 68 is only on the defined benefit portion of that 36%. There's a piece of that that is for healthcare, which is the OPEB piece, and that will then be on your books. That will start in 2018. And just some future challenges that I'm sure you guys are all aware of, but as we talked, just the rising retirement rate increases normally for a school district, it can be about 50 cents on every dollar or more that they're paying for retirement health and all the benefits for their salaries that they have on the books. And then also the new OPEB that's going to be hitting your books soon. And then also just keeping up to date with all the new accounting pronouncements and staying abreast with the early morning legislation. And overall, I will take any questions on the audit piece. I do want to say thank you to Jackie, Rochelle, Bob, and Paula, and the whole business office staff. It was a great audit to be on. Everybody was very helpful. They got all the information ready on time. And especially being the first year, sometimes it's like, oh no, we have new auditors. What are they going to make us do? I hope it was painless. I know we looked at a lot of stuff. And we kind of gave them the rigor mark. They were very positive and very helpful. So we want to say a special thank you to that. And then we'll take any questions on the audit, and then we have another presentation.
Thank you. I just want to make sure it's clear that you did our audit, and we received an unqualified opinion from your audit, and that is exactly what we want.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it used to be called unqualified, and they changed it to unmodified, but it kind of sometimes sounds negative, but no. Unmodified is the best opinion you can get, and that is what you want.
And that's what we have, correct?
Yep. That's what you have.
Thank you. Go ahead, Bob. I appreciate that, again, this is your first year. And, you know, momentary weakness, you know, significant deficiencies. Every term is positive, and I appreciate the staff's contribution. This reflects on a year-long effort from our finance staff to make sure that we comply. And your term, a terrific fund budget balance, to indicate that our projections and what our expenditures met our income, again, indicates that it was a well run throughout the year. This is even though you do your job once a year, this represents the work of people throughout the year. And it reflects on the district, and it's very important that the state sees this. As you said, they've taken on an additional oversight role. And it's, I just appreciate your time and your staff, and express appreciation for our staff for doing such fine work throughout the year. It reflects excellent on the district. Thank you.
Any other questions on this part? Okay, we'll move next.
This has
the
presenting, and then in the PowerPoint, you'll see reference to some different schedules. All of those schedules are included for you. I realize that this is the first time you're seeing the information. So if you, which I'll explain, but if you get done with it, I have cards here. I think all of you have my information. Some of you, my cell phone, and Rochelle has it. I will be happy to come back to a meeting for more questions or answer anything that comes up. It might take some time to look at, so that's totally fine. But we will dive right in. So in addition to our audit, we did some consulting services. Basically, with the timeline and what we did was we were requested to do some additional services based on some different compliance procedural things that we needed to look at with the business office and different accounts. Just some of them were informational purposes for you guys just to have in your packet, and some of them were testing that we did additional to what we normally would do for the audit. Overall, we did the work October 3rd, so that's kind of why we wanted to make sure we got it to you as soon as possible, but I didn't have it ahead of time. But we're going to report based on the results of it tonight, and then once you get into the details, we can make sure we look at any questions that you might have later. Overall, there was this, what you are guys are seeing is 15-16, so I want to make clear we didn't go back to any other fiscal year, so we focused all of our information on the 15-16 school year. And then also, well, I already said, but the numbers, because you guys did receive a letter that was agreed upon to the board of what we were going to look at, the numbers in the letter correspond here, you'll see, but they don't really correspond to your schedule, so I wanted to keep everything in chronological order for you. Hopefully it makes sense. Number one, we reviewed all the overall general ledger for unallowable costs. Specifically, we looked at memberships, associations, and donations to nonprofits. And then we did not find any that were used with school district funding that was to something other than basically an association that was school related. We found two that were paid to nonprofits, but both of which were not for donation or contribution. And that is what's unallowable, is a donation or contribution. They both were for dues. And that those results are shown on Schedule 1. Then for number two, we reviewed all balance sheet accounts to see if any outside groups were using district information. The result of that, we sent a blanket confirmation, and a blanket confirmation is we send a confirmation to a bank and say, please provide us any information you have for this EIN number, so that if it comes back to us and it has something on it that we don't see during the audit, we know there's something out there and we haven't matched the two up. So we did not find anything that of note that was came back, anything that came back with accounts that are supposed to be on your books and should be on your books. Number three, we reviewed the pay and any pay-related items for non-affiliated employees, and then we focused on the cabinet, including the superintendent, the business office staff, and then any employees who handle payroll. So if they have a role in payroll, we also focused on them. We wanted to make sure that we did a few things, that we validated the pay for the fiscal year. We tied it back to the approved board approved contracts. We also looked at any additional amounts that would have been included, so maybe if they got an expense reimbursement or something to that effect, and made sure that the expense reimbursement was valid, properly approved, and all of that. So there's a list. You have Schedule 2, 3, and 4 in there, which shows the results of that. But overall, everyone's pay that we looked at did tie to their contract. They did not receive anything that was included in the contract or a direct deposit. All of that information tied out exactly to their contracts. There was a couple employees that did receive some expense reimbursements during the fiscal year. The only thing that was reimbursed, though, was for mileage, and we did look at that, too. And there was nothing that was out of the ordinary or not approved or anything that I would think would be of a significant amount. Number four, we looked at transfers. So if you had a transfer coming out of a bond or capital project fund, if it's over a certain amount or not board approved, we would let you know. There was one noted, it was for $200,000, which was the audit, and it was approved. We had the source documentation from a board workshop where you guys went over the budget, and the budget details showed that you could, or that transfer was approved, and it was out of a committed fund.